Nearly 50 school children were injured when two double-decker buses crashed in West Yorkshire this morning. The pupils aged...
The teenager, who was 13, received severe head injuries in the fall and died this morning at Leeds General Infirmary.
Bus drivers claim they're at risk of being attacked. A group of pupils have been causing so much trouble that the school...
At least one person has died and more than 40 have been injured in a crash between a school bus and an articulated...
The vehicle, which was taking children as young as 5 to a swimming lesson, had diverted from its usual route.
School transport in the late 1990s. A catalogue of accidental death, serious injury and amazing escapes. Tonight, Close Up North asks, what's going wrong? Are the bus companies, the children or the school authorities to blame?
She used to set her alarm clock, she used to be up with the birds, and she'd come running down the stairs. She never had any breakfast, she used to buy it at canteen when she got to school. She used to shout, have you got my money? I used to throw money down to her, and she'd go off. I was stood in her bedroom, looking out the window, and then just watched her as she walked out, you know, at the square. She sort of looked back, but she didn't see me looking. She got on the school bus that day because it took her nearer, because she was to start a birthday party, you know, for a little girl that lives one of my neighbours. And that's why she apparently got on that bus that day.
Tanya Shand, a 13-year-old pupil at Roundhay School in Leeds, never returned home that afternoon. She'd been killed falling from the emergency exit of her school bus.
I don't know, it was just a tragic accident. At the end of the day, there was a fight on the bus between some kids and it all got rowdy and there was just loads of chaos. And as you can imagine, in a school bus with a load of kids, 60, 70 children, just coming home from school, obviously they're all hyped up. And in the midst of it all, the door's being opened and she's fallen.
As you go down to Prince Henry's, if you go round the car park, you'll see by the side of the tennis courts, if you pull in at the side of the curb there.
In bus garages every morning, drivers receive their orders while the rest of us are finishing breakfast.
Come on then, hurry up. Time's coming on.
This is one family's domestic ritual.
All right, James, you sure you've got everything?
Yeah.
Have you got your rugby kit then?
I don't need it today.
You need it tomorrow?
Yeah.
Is it clean?
Nope.
But multiplied 1,000 times, and the local bus company has on its hands a major logistical operation. In West Yorkshire, First Leeds serves 80 schools, and its drivers are on the road from 6 in the morning. It's the duty of local authorities to provide free transport to all children living more than 3 miles from school until the age of 16. This bus, taking children from outlying villages into Otley, is just one vehicle in a national task force. Every year, the school run will cost council taxpayers a staggering £450 million. The 40-minute ride into Otley ends safely at Prince Henry's school. In the mornings, children are often subdued, but there have been occasions when some youngsters have experienced a rude and frightening awakening.
We picked the children up at 8:35 that morning, and as we were driving along this road here, crashed straight into the barn door, and then skidded down the wall and ended up just there at the Mason's Arms pub.
I was thrown forward and got my youngest brother. He was sitting next to me and I pulled him over to me so he didn't hurt himself that much. I went forward and I hurt my side and I got my neck as well.
There were 16 children on the Gargrave School minibus when it crashed last April. Their injuries weren't serious, but many still have nightmares. The driver pleaded guilty to careless driving and was fined £120.
It's not the sort of thing that you expect to happen. I mean, you expect somebody to take your children to school and they're going to be safe. The last thing you expect is for somebody to ring up and say, well, your children have been in a bus crash and they're on the way down to Airedale Hospital. You look at the photographs and you think, well, you know, we could have ended up without any. We'd have only had the eldest left, that'd have been it. And it is really, well, it's about time something was done.
Tell me when it's high enough. Is the exhaust clear yet? Right.
Yes, that's fine.
Okay. The operator's contract was terminated and North Yorkshire County Council asked a local firm, Cadmans of Gargrave, to take over. Cadmans had previously had a close relationship with the authority until losing out under competitive tendering.
In May of 1991, completely out of the blue, we received a letter from County Hall terminating our contract, which prior to that we'd done for 20-odd years. After having built up a working relationship with parents and children, it was like losing a relation.
Cadmans had been told that their tender for the school run was too expensive.
If the main criteria is price, I think that is all wrong, because there's more to safety is more important than just pure and simple price. It's best value for money, a rickety old vehicle that isn't maintained properly, or a decent vehicle with a reputable driver belonging to a reputable firm, doing the job properly.
Today, Cadmans run the Gargrave school bus at a price 30% above that charged by the last operator. The contract will continue until next October. The new arrangements are satisfactory to parents who'd complained about the previous service for 2 years before the accident. But the school's head teacher sees the whole episode as a condemnation of the county's school transport policy.
It all smacks of cheapest as opposed to best quality. And I think during the course of the past few years, the compulsory competitive tendering has seen, not just in the realms of transport, but throughout education, whereby cheap services aren't necessarily the best and most effective.
The bill for transporting 14,000 children to school in North Yorkshire every year stands at £10 million. Transport contracts are reviewed every 4 years.
One of our main items that we are discussing is home to school transport. I hope that...
All contractors must meet a minimum safety standard. But after that, the county's education subcommittee has been criticised for accepting the cheapest bid and having little regard to a contractor's experience or the quality of its vehicles.
Our main guideline is price, but at the same time, these vehicles must be to a standard that is roadworthy. The specification is for a vehicle that complies with what is legally required. In other words, if it's a vehicle that statutorily now has to have seatbelts, it naturally has seatbelts. It must have a full test. It must have, if it is a large vehicle, the standard vehicle license that large coaches and such like now have to have. If it's a minibus, it must be fully tested. And when we inspect, as we do periodically, it must be in good order.
Present safety regulations governing school transport are complex and vary between vehicles. Double-decker buses needn't be fitted with seat belts, and children under 14 are allowed to sit three abreast. That's up to 130 children on one bus. Double-deckers are limited to a speed of 59 miles an hour. The same regulations apply to coaches if they're fitted with a speed limiter. If not, vehicles used for school transport must have seat belts. As from August the 1st this year, seat belt fixings should be tested as part of the MOT. Minibuses, that's vehicles carrying more than 8 but less than 16 children, have no speed restriction, but they must be fitted with seat belts, and the driver must ensure that they're being worn. Many local authorities run their own registration and training schemes, but the driver needn't have a PSV license. Crew-style minibuses with bench seats are no longer legally permitted to carry school children at all. In North Yorkshire, a team from the police traffic unit at North Allerton assemble in the car park of Richmond School. They're to carry out a spot check on vehicles bringing children into school. The unit includes police mechanics trained in the use of mobile brake testing equipment.
I was going to say, well, we were going to do the lights, screen, warning devices, doors, emergency exits, yeah. Passengers, and then the bloke at the back will do the rear lights, bodywork, wheels, tyres, steering, brakes, and then if we can later on, we'll do a brake test.
6 different bus operators are represented here. The checks will give a good indication of the overall condition of school transport.
Wipers. Washer.
If faults are found, operators will be served with a prohibition notice. All repairs must be made within 10 days.
That box on the end of that... Double link.
Over there. Oh,
yes. Watch. Clear on that. Okay, we're going to stop now. Yep. Brilliant. Keep it there, just keep your foot on the brake. That's recorded, you're breaking it. Yeah, you can go back in. Nearly 40%, which I think on the road. And bearing in mind you're not used to doing that kind of thing, I think that's a pretty good brake. I'll give you a printout of that so you can take it with you.
Right, Stuart, what have we got?
Right, just one double-decker with no first aid kit. And again, another double-decker. The fire extinguisher was a bit dodgy, and the emergency door buzzer wasn't working on the lower deck.
There was one with a loose fog light.
Last time we did the checks, we had 2 prohibitions on buses, which basically means they have to rectify the faults before they can go back in service. This time, I think the most serious defects are the 2 emergency exit buzzers not working.
Apart from that, they're okay.
We've been doing the checks now for 2 years, and I think they are getting the message. They don't have a lot of money to spend on the buses doing this contract work, but they're getting the message that we have to keep them safe, and we will continue doing these stop checks.
ROSPA, the Royal Society for the Prevention of Accidents, has done a study of the age and quality of the school bus fleet.
Kevin. The vast majority of vehicles provided for home-to-school transport are very elderly vehicles, usually provided by relatively small contractors, perhaps with 1 to 5 vehicles, vehicles between 7 and 12 years old. In some places, the level of school transport is excellent. There's no question about it. In others, the drivers don't seem to care about the work they're doing. There's nowhere for kids to put their luggage. In some places, the problem is really great, and parents don't have any right to be complacent about what's happening. And in a way, the parents have the opportunity of influencing things. They're voters. They can say to the local authority, we want better school transport. They can say it authoritatively and with pressure.
This is one of our 1995 Volvos with a van hall body.
At the Shearings coach interchange near Castleford, Pat Harris of the pressure group Belt Up School Kids is given a tour of one of the company's luxury vehicles.
This is one of our 46-seaters. Seats actually recline. Yep. And if you look, every seat has a seatbelt on it.
Well, I just try one. Do you find that most people wear the seatbelts?
I would say the majority of passengers use their seatbelts.
Busk wants coaches of this quality used to take our children to school.
This vehicle has all the safety standards we'd like to see on school transport. It has, for a start, the R66 standard in the roof, which means that if the coach rolls over, it will stay in one piece and it won't disintegrate, which often in the older, especially the pre-88 coaches, if they roll over, the coach roof is likely to crumple, and that isn't very good for the passengers. There's other things like the double glazed windows, they strengthen the whole structure as well. But more importantly, from the point of view of seat belts, in this type of coach, you will find that the seat belts are fitted to anchorage points which are built into the design structure of the coach, and that's very, very important.
Different by design, built better to last longer. Buses constructed with die-formed fabricated parts. The best built and safest small size bus on the market today.
Other countries treat their children differently. America's fleet of yellow buses is famous around the world. Built to the highest safety specifications, they're purchased in large numbers by state education authorities, who also provide escorts.
90 inches allows for more comfort and space per passenger.
In America, as far as you can get it right, they've gone a long way down the road. They have designated school buses, which are actually built and look like almost like tanks. So if someone hits them, there's a fair chance that your children are going to be a lot safer than the person who hits them. They have chaperones. They have a very good network system. It is slightly different in each state, but they do all have the big yellow bus, and you don't hear very many complaints. In past years, there was a survey done, and the outcome of that was, if we'd got it here now, I think we'd be very much happier than we are today.
Founded in 1981.
If buses like these were to be designed and built in Britain, they'd cost around £80,000 per vehicle.
One bus a day.
Lovely, I wish we could afford them.
It just comes down to cost.
It comes down to cost at the end of the day, yes, it comes down. I've used the term value for money, best value, call it what you like. At the end of the day, it is a bill that has to be paid, and it is a large bill, as I've already stated.
But in the corner of a Rotherham bus garage, a possible solution. A bus which may one day launch the yellow revolution here in Britain. This is First Mainline's response to a challenge thrown out by the Deputy Prime Minister. He wants companies to design a school bus which parents will have so much confidence in they won't feel the need to take their child to school by car. First Mainline reckon the cost of converting these coaches will be around £10,000.
This isn't a new vehicle, it's a vehicle which we're refurbishing. It's been completely stripped out. It has new floors, it'll have new seats. It will have all its seats fully belted, so we think it'll be safe. It'll certainly be giving the quality that I think parents will require. New lighting, and it'll have a complete repaint on the outside, so it'll be very visible to other road users when the vehicle is in the vicinity. And being a single decker, of course, the driver will be able to keep his eye on all the children, make sure that the whole thing is being operated safely. And it does give the possibility at some point, if we wish, of providing an escort who will actually travel with the children.
But will this experimental bus be a one-off or the first of a fleet?
We are looking to experiment with a fleet of possibly up to five to see if this principle actually works. We're talking to the local authority and the PTE, and we're going to select a school, and we're going to put all these ingredients together to see if these ideas and the commitment given by the Deputy Prime Minister will actually work.
But even if school transport were to be built to the highest standards, no bus company could account for one of its drivers deviating from his usual route and running his bus under a railway bridge, which is exactly what happened in Grantham earlier this month. Miraculously, all 68 children on board lived to tell the tale.
I looked over and I saw, and I kept saying to the bus driver, stop, and he just said, no, go back. And he didn't see the sign, and he just went ahead. We told everybody to duck, and they just went, and the roof came flying off, and he just kept going under the tunnel until it came off.
This accident focused attention on the driver, leaving parents to praise the quick reactions of their children.
They anticipated that there was going to be an accident, and they all shouted to duck down. Otherwise, my daughter was on the top deck of the front of the bus, and she could have said the bricks were eye level with her.
Think about the driver now. The driver has a very hard job. They've got an awful lot of responsibilities. It's a large vehicle. They're often driving in heavy traffic. They're always expected to be on time. I'm sure you all like to get to school on time in the morning, and you certainly don't like to be late home at night. They're expected to be friendly, helpful, to always have a smile when you're getting on the bus.
Companies like First Leeds believe a number of incidents have been caused through their drivers being distracted by bad behaviour. They regularly liaise with schools, giving talks at morning assembly.
And it wasn't at Prince Henry's, where somebody actually pushed and they fell into the road in front of the bus as it was approaching. And it was only the very quick thinking of the driver in stopping that bus that prevented a very serious accident. When you're leaving the bus, try and leave...
The idea here is to get across the professional driver's point of view. In school, as at home, children are closely supervised. But between the two, on the bus, their behaviour can get out of control, as video evidence collected from cameras located on buses throughout West Yorkshire clearly demonstrates. Here, a youngster picks a fight with another boy on the top deck. Both end up standing on the seats while other children look on. On the school run, petty vandalism can be a constant problem. Here, a girl on the right is scrawling graffiti on an interior panel. The words could be just her name, or they could be obscene. And here, a boy appears determined to kick out a window.
We've had difficulties with fights, we've had difficulties with bullying, we've had difficulties with objects being thrown around. Of course, this principally occurs on the top deck, and there is often a great deal of mayhem and stamping that can make it difficult for the driver to focus and concentrate on the job that he has to deal with. We had a particularly distressing incident a few years back in Bradford when the top deck of a bus was set alight by some youths setting fires at the back, and certainly we have had video evidence where that has occurred. And where we have that opportunity, we do bring it to the attention of the school and the parent to try and stamp out this kind of behaviour. And in that circumstance, it's very difficult for the bus company to do a great deal about it. It's really down to the individuals and the children's behaviour.
So reluctant are some parents to believe their child capable of this behaviour that some schools have asked their sixth formers to reenact the kind of scene drivers may be faced with. Cleaning up after the school run is now a routine duty in all garages catering for school children. But should the driver have tried to prevent this from happening? Bus straight to the police station. But is the children's behaviour the driver's responsibility, the school's, or the parents'?
Education authorities and teachers will say their responsibility starts once the child walks across the threshold into the playground, into the school premises. Many parents don't realise that they have a responsibility to ensure their children attend school. So between those two boundaries, there's quite a lot of room for argument and discussion. It has been mooted before that a transport contractor who's providing home to school transport, for example, is acting in loco parentis in place of the parent while the child's on the journey. The parent can't travel with the child, so the contractor must be carrying some level of responsibility for that child. So in that way, the contractor's agent, that's the driver, has responsibility for ensuring the children behave reasonably. And you'll probably know there are some instances where coach drivers have taken the vehicle, either stopped the vehicle, or they've taken the vehicle to a police station or to some other point and tried to deal with the problem behaviour on the vehicle.
When they face the inquest into their daughter's death in December, Tanya Shan's family won't just be asking how she died. They'll want to know what has been done to prevent such an accident from happening again.
I'd like to see supervision on school transport, definitely. Because how many more does it have to take before something's done about it? I mean, how many years ago have they been talking about it, saying they want something done, and now look, it's taken a child to die, my child to die, before anything's even been considered about it. I mean, I haven't heard anything being done about it since. I've still seen school buses with rowdy kids throwing things out the window and carrying on. See it every day. Still going on, nothing's been done.
The end of lessons at Prince Henry's and a well-rehearsed drill swings into action.
We first of all have staff on duty who supervise the boarding, and that's a crucial thing really, to put them onto the bus in a condition which we think they're going to be able to get home safely and pleasantly. We try and get the small children on first. Year 7 have been in the school only a week, and at this stage they do need a certain amount of protection. And thereafter, there are youngsters who have to get a particular bus, and we make sure that they have a priority card which allows them onto that bus so that they're sure to get home. As yet, we haven't got a formal prefectoral system on the bus, but the reports that I get from sixth formers do enable me to keep my finger on the pulse and to know if there is misbehaviour. There's no point in trying to deal with youngsters as if they were troops. They're not, they're young people, and above all, they're intelligent, and they do understand, and we work fairly hard in terms of getting a right attitude from them to get the good expectations that enable them to travel as self-respecting members of the public rather than as a horde.
Most journeys, like this one, end with a child's safe return. But the fact that in the past some haven't surely demands our constant vigilance.
You say you learn to cope, you learn to live with it, but it's not that easy. You just got to live day to day and you just sort of block it from your mind. You just don't think too deep about it. You know, you just go on and just bury it, sort of thing. You try to, but every now and again something comes up again and that it just brings it all back.
In all authorities, one of the first things to be cut is school transport. I don't think that parents are totally happy and confident that the school bus is safe or that the actions that are going on inside the school bus are safe, but they having to do it through lack of choice.
We have regulations in place for travelling livestock. And every so often they bring a few more measures in to upgrade that. We don't have any measures for travelling school children, any regulations at all. Does that mean that children are less important than animals?